Good morning. So let me borrow your attention. You can obviously continue eating. It's a wonderful pleasure for me to be here as we all get together to celebrate the powerful vision of Rita and Gus Hauser. And I had the privilege to work very closely with Rita during 11 years as we figured out how to continue moving this vision forward. And it was an inspiration to have had that opportunity. And today, and at lunch, we are going to be treated to something very special, which is a talk by our keynote speaker, Mohamed ElBaradei. Most of you know two very important things about our speaker. First, he was one of the leading international civil servants of the 20th century. He served as Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency from 1997 to 2009. In 2005, he shared the Nobel Peace Prize with his agency for their, this is a quote, efforts to prevent nuclear energy from being used for military purposes and to ensure that nuclear energy for peaceful purposes is used in the safest possible way. Quite an accomplishment. Second, he played a very significant role as a leader of the opposition in Egypt, first to President Mubarak and then to President Morsi. His name was frequently mentioned as a possible presidential candidate, and he briefly served as vice president of Egypt in 2013. So those two things you all know. What is less well known is Mr. ElBaradei's very strong links to NYU Law School and the role that the law school played in the launch of his career as an international civil servant. He received an LLM here in 1971 and a JSD in 1974, where he studied under the legendary Professor Thomas Frank, who many of you came to know and who sadly passed away a few years ago. In 1980, when Professor Frank became the head of the United Nations Institute for Training and Research, he asked Mr. ElBaradei to join him as a senior fellow in charge of the international law program at this UN agency. And that was his first serious stint as an international civil servant. That job led directly to a position at the International Atomic Energy Agency, where he eventually became the head. During the period that he was in New York working at the UN, Mr. ElBaradei taught at NYU Law School as an adjunct professor from 1981 to 1987. In 2004, he received an honorary degree from NYU. He's one of the few NYU graduates to have both earned a doctorate and then received an honorary doctorate. I vividly remember the speech he gave at the honorary degree dinner in 2004. He had just come back from Washington, having briefed President Bush about the lack of persuasive evidence about the existence of weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. This, as you recall, was the period where the Bush administration was making a decision about whether to invade Iraq. Now, sadly, Mr. ElBaradei's advice was not followed by the Bush administration, but we now know, 10 years later, that he was right. So I'm delighted to turn the microphone over to our keynote speaker, Mohamed ElBaradei, LLM 1971, JSD 1974, LLD 2004, Nobel Prize winner 2005.
Ricky, thank you very much for your very kind words. It's always good to come home. And NYU Law has always been home to me. Yesterday, Aida, my wife, and I walked down through memory lane. And you get to reflect on things. It gives you a sense of renewal, but also a sense of perspective. Some people are no longer with us, like Tom Frank. But I was happy to see Cafe Reggio that was there when I was here in the 60s, still around. And Mamoun Falafel, where I used to have my lunch or dinner sometime. It really is a great honor to be part of the 20th anniversary celebration of the Hauser Global Law School. This unique and visionary program, established through the generosity of Rita Ann Gasshauser, understood early on the importance of the exchange of ideas and perspectives among lawyers everywhere for building just and peaceful world. Norman Dorson, I think yesterday at lunch, said that the idea came when people realized that the world is changing very much and lawyers need to work differently. I would say today that lawyers not only have to work differently, but have to think differently. I think that is really the challenge we are facing today. In this fast changing, highly interconnected, and increasingly turbulent world, the importance of such a global order is becoming more urgent than any time before. Many of us could agree that inviolable human dignity, as defined in the German Constitution, to be the mother of all basic rights, has become a key to this order. But the challenge is how to get there. At this moment in history, our reality is quite paradoxical. Amazing creativity and ingenuity have enabled us to make a huge leap forward in the way we understand our world and our human condition. But at the same time, there is a strikingly inability to translate these achievements into a new mindset. A mindset that would help us to remodel our world order and understand the complexity of the relationship between its national and international dimensions. In the last 10 years only, we had the world's first artificial organ transplant, the discovery of the Higgs boson particle, the launch of social media and other forms of communication, the groundswell uprising in the Arab world and other grassroots movements, the latest Occupy Central, the challenges, the repressive status quo, social inequality, and even traditional democratic institutions. But with breakthrough in science and technology and widespread resistance against the social, economic, and political status quo, our ability to respond to demand for change has been inert and inadequate. Repression and gross violations of human rights remain the hallmark of a third of the world nations. And senseless, dehumanizing, and destructive conflicts dominate the human timeline. Throughout history, we organize ourselves in a multiplicity of ways. The city-state, empires, and sovereign states. But the goals of peace and justice remain as elusive. We developed a human rights law to promote human dignity, and a humanitarian law so when we fight, we kill each other more humanely. But both laws are now cited for violation more than for compliance. We created the League of Nations and the United Nations to resolve disputes and limit the use of force. Yet, the Second World War could not be averted, and appalling violence and growing conflict still thrive. Recently, we developed a system of criminal accountability, but many major actors are not party to the ICC statute, with the result that criminal accountability has become limited to the weak and defeated. We prohibited certain types of inhumane weapons, but the mother of all humane weapons, nuclear weapons, continues to be alive and kicking. In addition to the lack of freedom and security for many, other critical aspects of human dignity remain disgracefully absent. 2.8 billion people continue to survive on less than $2 per day. Around 900 million people go to bed hungry every night. And millions die every year because of lack of access to medical care. This year, 1.7 million people are dying from HIV/AIDS because they don't have access to antiretroviral. These are not simply numbers. These conditions inevitably lead to a deep sense of injustice, anger, and loss of hope. They created the most fertile ground for conflicts, violence, and extremism. Extremism which wear different masks of ideology, religion, ethnicity, and uber nationalism to commit the most heinous of crimes. The global response remains shamefully erratic and subjective, predominantly depending on geopolitical interest. In Congo, Rwanda, Darfur, and recently Syria, despite colossal death tolls, the international community did little more than wring its hands or perform a second-rate kabuki dance. Since those places either were of low strategic value or conflicting interest paralyzed the Security Council. In Afghanistan and Libya, the international community stepped in, and NATO and other forces were swiftly deployed. But in all these conflicts, lost in translation, are the millions of natives killed or had their life ruined only to become collateral damage. The United Nations recently almost begged for $12.9 billion to support 52 million people in 17 countries facing acute humanitarian crisis. This critical humanitarian aid is around 0.5% of what we spend on military arsenals, which stand today at $1.7 trillion. The problem, therefore, is by no means lack of fund, or I hope, a lack of compassion or solidarity. It is primarily a blinkered mindset, unable to see the big picture, or even where its long-term interests lie. At the end of the day, as it is today, it really depends who is dying and where. Is it not telling that we always know exactly how many Westerners have lost their lives in any of these conflicts? But no one bothers to keep more than the vaguest tally of local victims. Are we shocked then when we see growing anger, distrust, and extremism? The logic on the other side goes like this. If you don't care about the value of my life, why should I care about yours? And if you don't consider me a human being, why do you expect me to act as one? What do you make of all of this? Truly impressive progress on one hand, and utterly unconscionable behavior on the other. Is this the yin and yang of human nature? Are we condemned to repeat this cycle of violence, misery, and extreme inequality forever? I continue to believe, however, that peace and equity is not just a chimera, and that they are attainable if we change our perspective and mindset. We must first understand how connected we have become. This is the genesis, in fact, of this global law program. Connected in terms of opportunities and risks. The swift movement of people, information, ideas, funds, goods, and services across national and international boundaries has redefined human interaction. We are all connected more literally than ever before. The city is now the planet. And New York City, I think, is a very good testimony to that. But this connectivity is not limited to opportunities. It is also includes risks. When we consider our most significant global challenges, terrorism, climate change, weapons of mass destruction, communicable diseases, cybersecurity, human trafficking, and illegal drugs, we see that they are all threats without borders. Traditional notions of sovereignty and national security are being constantly challenged. By their nature, these threats require multinational and often global cooperation. No one country can overcome these threats on its own. And we are seeing vivid example of this right now. This change in landscape should lead to a corresponding change in mindset. The core values we share, sanctities of human life, respect for human dignity, equity, etc., must be universally applied. And our compassion and solidarity must transcend borders, race, religion, and ethnicity. For by now, we should have learned that I am not free unless everybody is free. And I am not secure until everybody is secure. We need to grasp the fact that despite our different perspectives and priorities, we are becoming a community, gradually sharing the same set of core values. It's one cake, albeit with different icing. As with any family, the human family will have diverse economic and social levels among its members. But our responsibility is to ensure that every member has a minimum standard of human dignity. Disagreements and competing interests are natural in the family, but those can no longer be resolved through the use of force. This is no longer simply an ethical or moral question, but it is more and more a question of survival. If we understand that our actions eventually come back to haunt us, no matter where we are, we will have to think twice before ignoring the suffering around us, neglecting inequality, or starting a war. Second, we must understand the intimate connection between the extreme inequality and insecurity that disfigure our world and that can, if not attended to, blow up in our faces. Inequality ultimately leads to insecurity, and these insecurities cannot be resolved by military power. Smart bombs cannot feed the hungry or overcome extremist ideologies. Tanks and missiles cannot fight disease or solve chronic conflicts. Third, we must understand the horrific danger we face by the continuing existence of nuclear weapons. The abolition of nuclear weapons is alarmingly not a fashionable topic today. Yet, it is evident that with the technology out of the box, and as long as some countries choose to rely on nuclear weapons, either directly or through a military alliance such as NATO, others will eventually seek to acquire them. security cannot be based on a doctrine that says some are more equal than others. It is imperative that no more countries should acquire nuclear weapons, clear. But to that end, it is equally imperative that nuclear weapon states move seriously towards nuclear disarmament. They must make good on their obligation more than four decades ago under the Non-Proliferation Treaty, not only to pursue negotiations in good faith, to divest themselves of these weapons, but also, in the words of the International Court of Justice, quote, the obligation to achieve a precise result, nuclear disarmament in all its aspects. Cynically, however, all nuclear weapon states are moving in the opposite direction and are continuing to modernize their arsenals. It borders on insanity to me that a quarter of a century after the end of the Cold War, we still have around 17,000 nuclear weapons in existence, 2,000 of them on alert status. This despite repeated warning by some of the most prominent strategic experts, such as Henry Kissinger, Bill Perry, George Shultz, and Sam Nunn, and others, that reliance on nuclear weapons is becoming increasingly hazardous and decreasingly effective, unquote. Fourth, we must instead understand that our world order as it now stands need to be revisited and reshaped. International institutions are becoming steadily dysfunctional and are sorely in need of reform. The United Nations system of organizations continue to suffer from structural deficiencies and or lack of authority and resources. One result is a paralyzed system of collective security. The Security Council failure to take preventive measures or provide adequate responses over the years has led to conflicts continuing to fester, violence continuing to rage, and misery continuing to spread. In the word of Navy Pillay, the former United Nations Chief for Human Rights, quote, greater responses by the Security Council would have saved hundreds of thousands of lives, unquote. Other international organizations in practically all fields of human activities are becoming highly polarized and increasingly paralyzed. We are steadily, in my view, facing a serious crisis of governance. Governments that pursue short-term parochial politics, which fail to address long-term global challenges in need of cooperative policies, and international institutions that are bereft of the tools required to adequately address these challenges. The WHO, the World Health Organization, recently acknowledged that it could have acted more quickly to confront the Ebola outbreak if its budget for outbreak and crisis response has not been cut by 51% in 2013 and 2014. All this begs the question whether the status quo is sustainable and whether the delineation of authority and power among governments and international institutions needs to be recalibrated. Fifth, we need to shift the emphasis in the interaction between North and South, East and West, from rivalry and competition to cooperation and complementarity. Using economic models that focus on achieving peace through prosperity, advanced science and technology for development, and focusing on values and institutions that promote dignity and champion democracy. In other words, soft power. Transition to dignity is about developing norms, institutions, and the culture that support them. As we have learned again recently in the Arab world, democracy is not an instant coffee. It takes time. But our only option is to nurse and support the process. If we invest half as much creativity and resources into human dignity as we spend on weapons of war, our world order could become just and peaceful. The challenges we face are bigger than any single country, conflict, or issue. We can regain our morality and rationality by remembering a few simple facts: that we are one human family, irrespective of our seeming differences, that every member of that family shares the same hopes and same aspirations to fulfill his or her dreams and potential in freedom and dignity, and that justice, respect, and dialogue and not violence, polarization, or demonization are the only productive ways to settle our differences. William James said, "We are like islands in the sea, separate on the surface, but connected in the deep. What remains is a change of mindset to capture that reality." Let me end with the hope that until we reshape our global paradigm, we will continue to be guided by the word of Fyodor Martens, a person familiar for those who are doing international humanitarian law. "Our ultimate protection," he said, "is the principles of humanity and the dictates of the public conscience," which I'm sure we have a lot of it in this room and at the law school. Thank you.
So I'll tell people that they can ask questions. Thank you, Mohamed, for a fascinating, though not altogether optimistic, talk about the state of the world. Mohamed has very graciously agreed to take questions. So if you can raise your hands, I'll recognize people, and we're open for questions for our speaker. Rita.
So I'll ask you, Mohamed, the obvious question. What is the future as you see it for Egypt?
I think I answered that, Rita, already. But, well, I think the key in Egypt, as in everywhere else, you need is a pluralistic system, an inclusive system, a system based on respect of the rule of law. We still have a long way to go. Well, this is one of the major issues we are facing. Rita asked about Egypt. You asked about global norms. How do you get people to agree on the core values, the basic law, the constitution, the norms of the world order? We had tremendous difficulty in Egypt over the last 3 years over getting a constitution where everybody can buy into it. You can't get a constitution with a religious flavor and then another one with a military flavor. You need a constitution that reflects the core values we all believe in. You know, the four freedoms, freedom of expression, of belief, freedom from fear, freedom from want, you know. It is not easy, but I think we need to understand, as I'm trying to do, and I'm not trying to be pessimistic, I'm trying to be realistic, is that unless in our globalized world, unless we learn how to live together, we are going to succeed together or we are going to fail separately. There is no other options. Well, I think again, we need to abandon parochial politics. We need to understand that unless we work together for the common good, we're going nowhere. Look at, you know, at the so-called terrorism, extremism. Look at climate change. Unless you adopt a policy that is not just based from your blinkered parochial, you know, thinking that, you know, I can win it all. You know, and try to see how we can develop cooperative policies. Unless we will go nowhere. I mean, you look at any of the problem I mentioned, you know, we're moving nowhere. I mean, we developed this responsibility to protect, you know, in 2005 with great fanfare. Now, when you look around it, you know, it rings hollow. You know, and it is not just that we have to talk the talk, as we do at the UN. We just have to walk the walk. And I think, frankly, I mean, one suggestion, if I may, that we need, we mean the people, need to get involved. You know, our future is too important to be left to politicians, in my view. We need all to be involved, whether in climate change, in environment, as Ricky is quite active, in arms control, in defense issues, in every area. We need to get involved, and we need to say that's not where we want to go. Look at the Security Council today. I mean, they've started to say that it is not working because of veto. Everybody knows it is paralyzed because of veto. Have we tried to do anything about limiting veto or even abolishing vetoes? Look at the composition. How on earth can you get a country like India that represents 1/6 of the world out of the decision-making process? There are things that's so obvious. The writing is on the wall, you know, that unless you change, you know, the system, the architecture you have developed after in the 40s, you know, and adjust the system of governance to reality, we are going to sink as we are, as I see it right now. You know, we are not moving on any one issue forward. In fact, we continue to, you know, circle around where we are. There's no leadership. You need leadership, of course. You need vision. And these two are lacking today in the world.
Yeah.
I would like to ask, where do you see the role of civil society on the internal field and international?
Civil society is a key at the national level, at the international level. When we look at the Arab Spring, as it is called, it is not moving forward because there is no civil society. There is no thriving civil society. Civil society was not allowed to thrive. We are all coming from 50, 60 years of repression, where civil society was completely squashed. And unless you have civil society, political parties, NGOs, labor unions, professional association, unless you have a thriving, this is the people. I mean, you need to be organized. You know, as I said, people need to be involved, but people cannot get involved unless they are organized. You know, I know situation right now when some NGOs are being prosecuted in a country I do not want to mention because one of the accusations that they are spreading democracy and freedom. So it's a long way to go, but civil society is absolutely key.
Armin.
Thank you very much. Could you please tell us what, in your long experience, has been the moment that gives you most hope that at the end you will get it done?
Well, I think what gives me hope is this uprising. People are crying for dignity and freedom. I mean, you see it everywhere in the Arab world. It will take time, as I mentioned, but it gives me hope that people understand. I mean, it's within themselves, this crying for dignity, whether freedom of belief, freedom of expression, freedom to have a future, to have a job, to have the ability to be mobile. I think this awareness right now, and social media has become absolutely key in that. Everybody everywhere knows what kind of grass on the other side of the fence. So you cannot hide the facts, reality, from anybody. Everybody knows that the grass could be greener, and everybody is going to work on it. I have a lot of hope also on the youth, many of you. You are the future. I mean, in many of the, I think almost globally, 50-60% is under 30. Our generation and generation under me, we haven't done great. You know, we haven't left you the best world. But you have learned a lot, and we are trying to tell you what is wrong. But it is you who can shape the world, redefine the world, make a world based on compassion and tolerance.
Jerry.
China?
How does China fit in?
I would not want to go country specific, but I mean, there are different ways we have seen to go about democracy and to go about freedom, you know, and to go about dignity. Dignity is not just freedom of expression and of belief. Dignity, primarily, as I have seen, is people to have the basic needs first. We have seen in South Korea, I can mention, you know, that it was a dictatorship, but then managed to develop a large middle class, and next step was crying for freedom, and now it's a democracy. Whether you go this route, first focus on economic and social development, or you go a combination of, you know, all different aspects of freedom, as India is doing, you know, or Russia tried to do. It's a different route. But to me, wherever you're coming from, the goalpost is very clear. Every single human being has to have the dignity, as I said, as defined in the 19 first articles of the German Constitution. It is a serious problem. I've experienced that firsthand, particularly at the International Atomic Energy Agency. I was paid by these governments, and they never accepted or liked that I tell them that you are wrong, that you are violating the law. And I was told sometimes bluntly, we are paying your salary. You know, sure, you are paying my salary. But I said, you know, I'm accountable to everybody, and I'm not accountable to anybody. And accountable to the international community. But it is a serious issue, and that's why I mention here this whole delineation of authority between international institutions and governments need to be redefined, need to be revisited, because the world has changed so much that you need these international institutions with teeth, with authority, with resources. This is for different lecture for different day. but I can tell you, we just have to start, you know, and we cannot just continue to talk about nuclear disarmament and feel good about ourselves. Why do we have, and again, ask any strategic expert, ask Bill Perry, ask Henry Kissinger, you know, these are people are not blue-eyed idealists. You know, ask them, why do we still have 2,000 nuclear weapons on high alert status? Why do we have, you know, why do we still rely on nuclear weapons as the essential cornerstone of our national security? You know, we are, in my view, if we continue the way we are sleepwalking into self-destruct. You know, again, I do not want to be an alarmist, but that is, you know, unless we change course, unless we understand that, as, you know, Bob McNamara once said, you know, you cannot learn with nuclear weapons. You know, one mistake and that's the end of it. You know, and but have we done, and this is again applied here to the law school, you know, public policy school, have we done enough work on what kind of world we could have without nuclear weapons? What kind of security system we could have without nuclear weapons? So we need to start providing alternative. We need to start providing ideas and sell and advocate these ideas. And we haven't done that, frankly. I mean, it is not just we talk about it, we have to come with alternative, because you will get a lot of people say, well, nuclear weapons have kept the peace since the 40s. You know, yes, it did. By, as Bill Perry said, through good luck and not through good management. You know, and we cannot continue to have, you know, our survival depending on good luck.
Yes, Jose.
So if you were named by President Obama the new ISIS czar, how would you help us rethink our approach to the so-called war on ISIS? What would you tell him?
Will you accept the
I don't think I will accept. But if I'm asked at least to give my views, I'll say there are short-term solution and long-term solution. Short-term solution is some military action. But that's not the solution. The real solution is a political solution. Why do we have ISIL? Is ISIL the aftermath of the mismanagement of Iraq, of the disbandment of the Sunni army in Iraq, of the oppression by the Sunnis in Iraq by the Shiites? Is the creation of opposition, armed opposition in Syria. I mean, chickens are coming home to roost, basically, I would say. You know, that you cannot just say, oh my God, we have now a terrorist organization. But we have to understand why this terrorist organization came about and try to work, get rid of it, but work on the environment that created that organization, because if we don't, we'll have more and more of that organization.
Yeah.
Is it for the better or for the worse that the Security Council has not been involved yet in the question of ISIS?
I think it's for the worse. I think any action has to be sanctioned by the Security Council. I mean, again, I would like to continue to see some legality, some legitimacy, and I don't want to see a repeat of Iraq. I don't see a repeat of Kosovo, even if it was legitimate but not legal. We need to see always that there is a system of legality at work. You need to get them. You need to get them involved. But again, as we know, for example, when the Security Council got involved in Libya, the mandate was overstretch, to say the least. And as a result of that, you got complete paralysis now in the Security Council to authorize any collective use of force. So you need to, again, I come back to some of the norms or we talk about. Law is a set of norms, but these norms have to be deeply rooted in some of our basic values. Equity, respect, good faith, and That applies to the Security Council and Security Council members. You know, we have to have norms, but the norm, not any norm is a law, and not every law is legitimate. And we need to see that every norm is legal and legitimate because, as I said, it corresponds at the end to the principles of human consciousness. That is our, that's my, at least my measure. So you need to get the Security Council involved, but you need to get the Security Council involved into the whole, if you need to get them into ISIS, you need to get them to look into Iraq, into Afghanistan, into Syria, you know, into Palestine. You need to get them to look at the whole gamut of problems that has been festering for generations. I saw the legal note by the current administration on Syria, you know, bombing Syria. You know, and this is something, again, for lawyers to look at. I mean, they're basically saying that we are bombing Syria because the government there is not able to deal with ISIL, or not able or willing to do it. But that's the country, the regime there, horrible as it is not able because you disable that regime. So, you know, how it's like a Kafkaesque sort of logic, you know, and all these issues we need to put it on the table, not us. I mean, member states need to put it on the table and discuss it in honesty, in fairness, but again, understand that unless they find the norms, a formula, to be able to buy into it together and understand that this is all for their common good, we will go nowhere.
But as I indicated in my introduction, you were part of a group of prominent people who made a case against the Iraqi invasion, and you had lots of important information to bring to the table. Has that group thought about whether the case could have been made in a more persuasive way, whether sort of in retrospect 10 years later, whether there's anything other that could have been done to persuade the Bush administration, or was that basically a futile effort from the start?
I think, you know, again, on reflection, Ricky, it was not really about weapons of mass destruction. I mean, it was primarily about regime change, you know, and they tried to use us as a tool, you know, or as a pretty face, you know, to justify what is something that was not justifiable. But it was about a regime change. It was about this fantastic idea that there will be a regime change in Iraq and Iraq will be the beacon of democracy in the Middle East. And now, again, you can look at and compare. Saddam Hussein was a horrible dictator, but look at Iraq today, look at Iraq then, and it raises a question. Again, I leave it with you. What do you do with dictators? We have like 30 or 40 of them around the world. You know, are we going to go use military force there? How can we deal with them? And you are dealing between the bad and the worse, you know, but you want also to continue to be within the constraint of legality. It's not an easy issue, and it's probably issue specific or case specific, but no, in Iraq, I think it was never, you know, I mean, I remember, you know, and this is again in my book, which I try to promote here, but when we, Hans Blix, my colleague, was doing chemical and biological, and I was doing nuclear, we went to see Cheney before we started the inspection. He made it very clear. I mean, he said, either you are going to disarm Iraq or we are going to discredit you, quote unquote. You know, so this was a distinguished vice president. And then, you know, then when I started to mumble stuff about that we haven't seen anything, you know, at all, and that we haven't seen any imminent danger, he started to rattle about the agency, you know, sleepy dog, and everything you can imagine. After the war, all he said, oops, I misspoke. That is the apology I got. He misspoke.
You get the last question.
Can I come back to your first principle, which was that we live in an increasingly interdependent world, and that should somehow waken people up to the fact that, you know, out of enlightened self-interest, we actually have to work together. So you can talk about climate change or nuclear war or Ebola or whatever. The problem is that if you look around Western political cultures, no one ever gets elected on the basis of overestimating their interdependence in the world. fundamental aspect of our political culture which denies the very deep interdependence which you see as being a prerequisite to change. How do we challenge that fundamental political culture?
By getting more educated, by having more global law program as we have here, by having different schools at, you know, doing international politics, by making sure that people understand and see through the fallacy of the politician who are thinking short term, what is in it for me in midterm election. That is not our yardstick. We need to look long term, and we look to look what is good for, not for me alone, but for everybody.
Mohamed, thank you so much. So Mohamed, thank you so much. That was a fascinating talk and Q&A session, and we can now add Hauser, 20th anniversary keynote speaker, to your already very long and distinguished NYU Law School resume. Thank you very much.